It's that time of the week when former football and sports stars share their stories. It happens all right here, right now, on Thursday Night Tailgate. With your hosts, Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari. Guys, have some fun. Enjoy the guests. Take it away.
Thank you, Joe. Good evening, everybody, and thank you for coming back and joining us today on Thursday Night Tailgate, your home of the NFL Alumni Association and the Gridiron Greats. TNT is brought to you by the great folks over at Kyven Foods, Coastal Orthopedics, the Louisville Slugger Museum and Factory, and the French Lick Resort. I'm your host, Chris Mascaro, and tonight my co-host, Bob Lazzari, and I have five great guests that we're looking forward to sharing with you tonight. First up, we're going to get a return visit from former Redskins All-Pro defensive back Mike Bass. Mike is forever linked, you know, with former Dolphins kicker Garo Yepremian for his interception return for a touchdown back in Super Bowl VII. What most people don't know is that Mike and Garo played together with the Detroit Lions and were pretty good friends prior to that play, and we'll have Mike retell that story, plus get his thoughts on his alma mater, the University of Michigan, and the Redskins for this upcoming season, plus a whole lot more. Mike's going to join us here about 15 minutes from now. Then former Patriots Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins. You know, Tony joins us every single week here on Thursday Night Tailgate. He'll be back in his regular time slot at the bottom of the hour. We'll talk to Tony about Bill Belichick's legacy. You know, for that matter, you might as well throw in Tom Brady's as well. You know, in the shadow of Spygate and Deflate Gate. How much does he think that's going to haunt those two over the course of history? So we'll talk about that and a whole lot more when Tony is with us at the bottom of the hour. Return visit from Dr. Stephen Novicky. Doc has been a great friend of the show since very early on. He is the founder and inventor of ShockStrips. Like, you know, we say all the time here on this show, you know, those things should be mandatory on every football helmet because they reduce the level of impact on helmet-to-helmet hits. We'll get an update on the latest developments with ShockStrips and with Doc when he joins us a little bit later in the hour. We'll kick off hour number two with former Titans and Rams linebacker Will Witherspoon. Since retiring from the NFL a couple of years ago, Will has become a sideline reporter for ESPN Radio covering the Rams, so we'll get his insights on the Rams for this upcoming season. We'll also talk about his alma mater, the University of Georgia, and what he expects from them under first-year head coach Kirby Smart, and a whole lot more when Will joins us at the top of the next hour. And then we'll round out the show by catching up with another one of our favorite guests here on the show, and that's former Cardinals Pro Bowl linebacker E.J. Jr. We've really enjoyed getting to know E.J. over the last few years. He's always such a great guest. He's on the ballot this year for the College Football Hall of Fame, and as a voting member, I'm proud to tell you that I voted for E.J. this year. So we'll talk about that, plus get his thoughts on his alma mater as well, the University of Alabama. You know, we'll talk more about his playing days there and with the Cardinals and the Dolphins. Plus his coaching days now at Delaware State. So EJ is going to join us about 90 minutes from now. So we've got a lot of good friends back with us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. We're going to have a whole lot of fun. So sit back, relax. Let us take your mind off everything else going on in your life for the next couple of hours. Start things off like we always do here on TNT, and that's by going up to Eastern Connecticut, the home of my good friend and co-host, Mr. Bob Lazzari. Bob, how are you tonight, my friend?
Good evening, Chris. And I heard you're trying various ways to stay cool down there. Is that correct?
Indeed. I tell you, you know, here in, they don't call it Hotlanta for nothing. You know, as we were sharing off air, I had the privilege of playing with my father up in his member guest this past weekend up in just outside of Chattanooga, where afternoon time saw about 97 degrees. So if I had had a raw chicken or something, a little rosemary, I could have roasted us a chicken for dinner while we were out playing off the back of our golf cart. Hot one up there, hot one here in Atlanta all week long. I tell you, you know, Bob, we've talked, you know, we talk a lot about the weather here on the show when we kick it off, but, you know, no rain for a very long time. Every once in a while we've gotten a sprinkle, but, you know, at this time of year, we're typically looking at afternoon thunderstorms because of the heat, but we've had absolutely, you know, no rain, no relief, really. We got rained on actually in the golf tournament last weekend, about an hour rain delay as a, you know, pretty big thunderstorm came down. But, you know, here in Atlanta, we haven't had much. And, you know, I got, you know, flowers and plants and all that stuff in the yard out back that, you know, I got to drench every night because it's tough to keep them alive when we got this kind of heat.
It's crazy, Chris. Same here as far as the lack of rain. They're giving all kinds of drought warnings, and, you know, you never think about it in New England. You think of a rainy spring. You think of all the snow from the winter melting. Well, we didn't get as much snow as we normally did, but when you go through a three-week stretch without getting any kind of downpours, this is what happens. And depending on your well system, and we live in an area, a rural area up here where it's mostly all well water, you got to be careful and watch yourself. So sometimes rain is not a bad thing, but 85
indeed,
and sunny and no humidity today, so I can't complain.
No, you
usually
cannot.
Hear me complaining on this show, but not now.
Yeah, good for you. Put this one in the bank. You're going to want to withdraw it a couple of months from now, I'm sure.
Oh, I'll come December, sure.
Bob, I want to start by getting a couple of thoughts on some things that have been topical around the league over the last week. And the first thing is the league is attempting to interview, you know, players named in the Al Jazeera report concerning performance-enhancing drugs. We saw that a few months back. And the players that they're looking to talk to are James Harrison, Clay Matthews, Julius Peppers, Mike Neal, and Peyton Manning. The NFL Players Association doesn't want the players to participate in any interviews unless the league can produce some concrete evidence beyond sort of this article that appeared in Al Jazeera. James Harrison, you know, said he would agree to the interview, but only on his terms. And his terms are, you know, the interview would take place at his house on a date and time of his choosing, and Roger Goodell had to be there. And since Peyton Manning is really he's no longer an active player, so he's not obligated at all to participate in the interviews. But the NFLPA is afraid he's going to, since he actually called for the investigation into the report. You remember months ago, because he angrily denied the accusation. So the NFLPA is worried that Manning cooperation could put the other four players in a very difficult public perception situation if they decide not to do the interview. So Bob, my question to you: we sort of all along, right? Coming clean, you know, come clean now. If you're guilty, you know, or innocent, because, you know, eventually the truth's going to come out anyway. If you cry to the heavens that you're innocent, and then, you know, the truth comes out, then, you know, well, you know, whatever happens to you is what you deserve, right? So, but if you're guilty and you know you're guilty, just say so. And, you know, I mean, we're a very forgiving society. You know, if guys said, you know what, hey, you got me. This is what I did. Here's why I did it. I'm really sorry about it. You know, and, you know, I'll never do it again kind of thing. And then you keep your nose clean. You know, it's in the news today and forgotten tomorrow, right? I mean, you know, for all the guys on the baseball side, you know, through the steroid era, right? You know, Andy Pettit is probably one of the guys that gets, you know, the least amount of grief for whether he did HGH, you know, many times or the, you know, couple of times that he said he did. You know, he at least came out and said, yeah, you know what? I did it. Here's why I did it. I was trying to get back, blah, blah, blah. And for the most part, we've sort of left Andy Pettit alone when we talk about the steroid era in baseball. So this is obviously on the same line, you know, along the same lines, Bob. Your thoughts on, you know, what these guys should do, what the NFLPA should do, and what you think about Al Jazeera and the claims that have come against these guys.
Well, you make a lot of great points, Chris. I think the main one you hit was Manning was so receptive a few months ago, almost welcoming the opportunity to have him investigated. And they're always going to fall back on that. We're going to say, okay, I know that he's retired now and doesn't have to do it. And if he's still willing and he wanted to do it while he was still playing, that's kind of there should be no reason for any of these guys on any terms, Chris. It doesn't have to be in anyone's specific living room or whatever. I mean, there should be no problem at all. But you're right, Chris. And where there's smoke, there's fire. I mean, I was just talking. I was at a baseball meeting today, and we all went back to the Ken Caminiti article in Sports Illustrated years ago and the guy that ran in the meeting, who I did an ESPN radio show with once, had said to me way back in the time, he said, this guy, you know, he's got to be off his rocker. There's not that much stuff going on. And I said, Rich, I said, look, this guy, he's on a downward spiral. He's you're going to find this guy dead somewhere. He has nothing to lie about. And then after that, everything just kind of opened up with Canseco. And you're right, Chris, about the whole forgiving thing. I mean, look at guys like Ortiz and Pettit. They became, especially here in the Northeast, two of the most beloved athletes around after the so-called steroid scandal. So you're right. I mean, if there's smoke, I mean, look, do any of us think that there's no steroids going on in the NFL? These are just happen to be four or five guys mentioned. I mean, are we that stupid that these guys are that fast and that big and that strong? I mean, let's face it. I mean, I agree with you. Come out clean. Get it out there. There may be some discipline involved. I mean, the NFL, their whole thing is, you know, there's a difference between disciplining and investigating. They're saying, hey, you know, if we have probable cause and we think we do, let's get to the bottom of it. So, but I think you and I are on the same page. Come out clean. It's never going to be clean, but, you know, if you did something, you'll be forgiven very shortly, right?
Right. You know, and you know, and we've been saying that, you know, more, and it's not on the PED side, but we've been talking about this with respect to Deflategate, right? You know, if Tom Brady had only said, you know what, you got me, you know, hey, I told the guys to, you know, let out a pound. I like the ball a little softer. That's just my preference. I didn't realize it was a big deal. I didn't really realize it was against the rule that there was a poundage, you know, that it had to be between 12 and a half and 13 and a half. I told them to let out a pound. My bad. I'll never do it again. You know what? We've said it all along. If he got a game, that would have been a lot, you know, and everyone would have moved beyond it. No big deal. But you know what? I didn't do it, you know, with the cell phone. And, you know, now it's been going on for, you know, a year and a half. And, you know, we're practically at the Supreme Court level here. And, you know, it's just another thing you add to the pile of things. And we'll talk about this a couple of times tonight, probably with Tony and with Will Witherspoon. But, you know, just another thing that sort of, you know, adds to the cloud that sort of hangs over the legacy of Belichick and Brady and the Patriots Super Bowl trophies. But, you know, you hope that, you know, if you know, and I'm hoping really if James Harrison did it, I mean, obviously I'm a homer with the Steelers. But, you know, hey, come to my house, come on my terms and all of that sort of thing. That sort of implies to me that he's got something to say. Right. Hey, you know, yeah, you want me to interview? You want me to talk about it? All right, cool. Come to my house and you have to be here. And it's going to be on this day and this time. And I'll tell you the story. So hopefully there's a story to tell and he tells it and it's out in the open and you know, away we go. Everyone just, you know, if you're calling this, you know, grandiose sort of thing and you want to put out terms and then all you're going to do is go, I know I didn't do it. Come on, man. Mm. You know.
So it's so just like our society in general. Everything is denial now, Chris, and trying to cover your butt. But you're right. I mean, that New England, the Deflategate, no matter what side you're on, whatever, it was the most horrible public relations move I've seen in a long time by any sports team. You know, as much respect as I have for the organization, the right up the road here, horrific. It, like you said, I mean, Brady could have came out and said, and we'll get more to this, hey, I did not really know the rule. If that was true, I mean, he could have been lying there, but you say it anyway. I didn't really know the rule. I prefer the balls a little less deflated. It's easier to throw. Blame me. Let's move on. Guess what, Chris? We're not even talking about this tonight.
Right. Yeah, that's exactly right. Bob, the other thing I wanted to get your thoughts on is the idea that the players, you know, reporting later on in the year is having, you know, and having more time away from, you know, the team's facilities and the training camps and all that sort of thing is actually leading to more injuries instead of less. It's something we've heard some teams and some players talking about since the new collective bargaining agreement went in place, you know, from, you know, the weight room workouts to conditioning drills and nutrition programs. According to one NFL executive, players get hurt more because they can't train or eat at the facilities and you're not supervised until later in the year. Typically they would be back in there around March. Now it's April. It's not enough time, you know, this one guy was quoted as saying, to get a player to be better. And, you know, and when you look at the second phase of OTAs, players are only allowed to be in the team's facilities about 4 hours a day. So under the CBA rules, you have 4 hours to lift, to watch film, to, you know, do your structured on-the-field activities. You know, there are no helmets, no pads, no competition, no hitting. So it's a lot of stuff sort of squeezed into a short span of time, and players are complaining that, you know, the process is feeling rushed. So they also interviewed a linebacker. Again, they're kind of keeping, you know, the players' names out of it to this point, but they interviewed a linebacker who remarked that they don't have enough time now to get their bodies where they need to be. Guys aren't really fully ready because they are pushed, you know, to be, you know, a part of the, you know, these offseason workouts that, you know, hey, they're condensed time. They're not a bunch of them. And that's why we're seeing higher injury rates. So, Bob, it's sort of an interesting concept that the less amount of time that the guys are in camp and are, you know, being competitive and doing all the things that they used to do, you know, 10, 15, 20 years ago. Now they're saying that is actually to blame for why we're seeing more injuries. Your thoughts on that?
Wow. And we've talked to so many guys about this, Chris, as far as their bodies taking beatings over the course of a season, how rough the game is now. If you talk to some of the, I want to say some of the more old timer type guys, they'll probably tell you that, yeah, there's not enough hitting going on now. There's not enough time. They need more time to, acclimate to the NFL and how tough it is. You know, we've talked to guys that say to us, the game is so rough, your bodies just take a beating. Now, we know a lot of these guys, Chris, they have their own personal trainers. They have their own strength and conditioning coaches. In a way, you can see that, maybe 30 days shouldn't be a big deal, you know, nutrition-wise and everything. That shouldn't be. If you're a pro athlete, maybe that shouldn't be in the equation. But then you look on the flip side, Chris, and I think especially about quarterbacks and things about these complicated offenses and all that these guys, especially the young guys, have to learn over the course of a 16-game season is phenomenal. And giving up 30 days of that, that's incredible. I mean, it's almost like taking, you know, a college schedule and you know, not showing up for class for like 8 weeks and expecting to do well in a course, you know.
Right.
Because there's
Good
such
point.
A big learning curve. So in one way, I get it. You know, they said if you're not used to the hitting, Chris, when you do get hit pretty good, you're not going to react to it that well. Then again, you want to limit injury risks by too much happening. And how many times have we seen guys go into a season hurt? That's never good. I think it depends on the athlete. They're all different body types, Chris, all different as far as their, again, their own personal training. These guys pretty much know, I would think, by year three, what needs to be done on the off season and how much hitting needs to be done. Maybe they should take it on a player-by-player basis, but it is a fascinating topic, and I think it's going to be always controversial because these guys are so much bigger and stronger than they ever were.
No. All good points, Bob. Yeah, it is going to be interesting to see, you know, as they continue to track these sort of things, I'm sure, over the next couple of years. And then CBA is in place anyway, so nothing is going to change, you know, anytime soon. But it will be interesting to see how things shake out and then what changes end up coming about as we get the next, you know, collective bargaining agreement. In case, you know, unless they want to try to open something up, I would imagine if you could show substantive data where we've got more injuries now, it would be in the player's best interest to take another look at it. But, you know, CBAs are CBA, so it'll be interesting to see what ends up coming out of it.
Yeah.
Bob, any updates on guests for you and Tony D'Angelo on your show Monday Night Sports Talk?
Next show is 7-11, Chris. Just nothing in stone yet. Again, we usually start planning maybe, you know, a week before or whatever, but I'm sure we'll come up with some kind of basket. Well, we go by seasonal, and depending on the guest, but we'll probably get some baseball people in here. We got a lot of minor league stuff going on now, local stuff. It's just a matter of just picking into the pile and pulling out some good stuff, as you know. So
absolutely,
that should be happening pretty quickly.
All right. Again, be sure to check out Bob and Tony on their show, Monday Night Sports Talk. You can stream their archive shows by going online to mondaynightsports.net. All right, everyone. Like we do here every week on Thursday Night Tailgate, we want to send out a big hello and an even bigger thank you to our military personnel that are listening in around the world on the Armed Forces Radio Network. We can't say thank you enough for doing what you do to protect all of us and our way of life. For everyone else listening in, thank you so much for doing so as well, and we hope you'll join us
and thanking our brave men and women serving to protect our freedoms and our liberties and every branch of the military service. If you happen to see a member of our military, whether it's in the airport, in a restaurant, or just sort of out and about in your daily life, please stop for a moment and tell them thank you are our real heroes. We also want to thank our veterans for your service and the sacrifices that you and your families have made for us over the years. Big thank you as well to Sean Cruz and the wonderful folks over at the Armed Forces Radio Network. It is an honor for us to have Thursday Night Tailgate as a part of your network. You can find our show by going to armedforcesradionetwork.org. And veterans, please continue to check out globalvoiceforveterans.org, a great site with news and articles that are geared specifically for you. You're going to find them very interesting and beneficial to you. Again, globalvoiceforveterans.org. TNT is brought to you by the great folks over at Kyven Foods, owned by our good friend and former Bengals and Falcons tight end and TNT Hall of Famer Reggie Kelly. If you want to be king of the grill this summer, folks, it is a must that you use Kyven Sweet Barbecue Sauce, ranked number 15 in the world by Barbecue Superstars. This barbecue sauce is a must for the big game or your tailgating needs. It is available at select Walmarts and Krogers throughout the eastern half of the country. For locations, online orders, and recipes, check out their website at kyven82.com. And Kyven is spelled K-Y-V-A-N. And if your local Walmart doesn't carry Kyven Sweet Barbecue Sauce, we'll request it. I'm sure they'll be happy to add it to their shelves for you. TNT is also sponsored by Dr. Peter Candelora and the great folks over at Coastal Orthopedics. Folks, if you're dealing with joint pain, whether it's in your shoulders, in your elbows, your hips, your knees, your feet, stop doing nothing and start doing what the gridiron greats do to get relief. Contact Coastal Orthopedics. They can get you back to enjoying life. For more information, you can find them online at bone-dr.com. Baseball season, like Bob talked about a moment ago, approaching the halfway point. And if you love the game and you're looking for a great place this summer to take your family for a wonderful vacation, you're going to love the Louisville Slugger Museum and Factory. It is a very cool experience for everyone in the family because you get to walk their live production line and see their bats being manufactured right there in front of you. A lot of cool exhibits. They still have the Ripley's Believe It or Not exhibit that has some bizarre baseball treasures you get to look at. They've unveiled a new life-size statue of Jackie Robinson, which is amazing. Don't miss the bat vault. You hear me bragging on that every single week here on TNT because you get to actually hold game-used bats from so many of the game's greatest legends. To find out more information about the museum and to book your visit, go to sluggermuseum.com. And also check out our friends over at the French Lick Resort. You want to talk about a fantastic place to stay and play golf or simply relax and enjoy yourself? What a fantastic setting they have there. Two championship golf courses designed by Pete Dye and Donald Ross. The Pete Dye course hosted last year's senior PGA championship in the LPGA Legends. The Donald Ross design course was the site of Walter Hagen's PGA championship victory back in 1924. They've got a great spa and a casino, my friends, a casino right there on the property as well. To find out more information and to book your stay, go to FrenchLick.com. All right, now back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line is Mike Bass. Let me remind you about Mike's background. He's originally from, and I hope I pronounce this correctly, Ypsilanti, Michigan. He was a three-sport star in high school, playing football, basketball, and he also ran track. Played his college ball at the University of Michigan. He was a 12th-round draft pick in 1967 by the Green Bay Packers. Mike played in the NFL from 67 to 1975 for the Packers, Lions, and Redskins. From 1969 to 1975, folks, when he was with Washington, Mike played in 104 consecutive games. Think about that, 104 consecutive games in football in an era in which Mike played them. In 1974, he was named All-NFC. Over the course of his career, he had 30 interceptions, 6 fumble recoveries, and he scored 3 touchdowns. He was a member of the Redskins team that played the undefeated Dolphins in Super Bowl VII. He famously returned Gerald Yepremian's batted fumble for a touchdown. In 2002, Mike was named one of the 70 greatest Redskins of all time, and fans of the 1968 movie Paper Lion may recognize Mike for his role in that movie. And for everyone out there who thinks that Deion Sanders, Richard Sherman, or Darrell Revis are the greatest cornerbacks of all time, let me give you this stat. Mike started in 84 games and appeared in well over 100 over the course of his career, and he allowed just 8 touchdown passes over the course of his career. 8. So before anyone goes crowning the best defensive backs of all time, you better take a look at Mike Bass's record. And we're thrilled that Mike Bass is back with us again tonight here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Mike, Chris and Bob here. Thanks for coming back on the show.
Hi, Mike.
Well, Chris, I thank you for inviting me again. It was a great experience then, and I'm really, really happy that you extended me another invitation.
So, Mike, I wanted to start our time out tonight by talking a little bit more about your relationship with Coach Vince Lombardi. And like I mentioned in your intro, you were drafted by the Packers. And then when Coach Lombardi left Green Bay for Washington, you ended up going there with him as well. So if you don't mind, talk a little bit about how that came about, going from Green Bay to Washington, and your relationship then with Coach Lombardi.
When I came out of Michigan, the Packers had drafted me, and, of course, the mystique of Coach Lombardi had already been established. And when I went to Green Bay, I went to Green Bay as a 12th-round draft choice. At the same time, one of my teammates at Michigan, John Rouser, was also drafted by the Packers. And it was he and I who battled for that last spot on the roster. And at that time, they had really three all-pros in their defensive backfield, Herb Adderley, Willie Wood, and Bob Jeter. So it was kind of nip and tuck for both of us, and we did the very, very best we could. And I was cut, the last cut, when it was so very difficult to get picked up by anyone else. But I recall that Coach Lombardi called me into his office, and he said, Mike, you can play in this league. And that was all that I needed. I just needed an opportunity. I was lucky enough to be picked up by the Packers, by the Lions, but that was really a wasted 2 years for me, and I couldn't wait to get away from the Lions. And when Coach Lombardi came out of retirement, he remembered me and asked me to come to Washington. And the rest of it is history. I think the first or second day in training camp, he put me in as a starter, and I was there ever since, even through the period of time when George Allen was there. So it was really lucky, and I really feel privileged to have been remembered by Coach Lombardi. And fortunately, he passed away after that first year. But I also feel pretty good that George Allen thought enough of me to keep me around as a starter for the remainder of my career. It's just a great opportunity. I had the opportunity to play with two of the finest coaches that have ever coached in the NFL, Coach Vince Lombardi and George Allen. I might add, though, that my defensive backfield coach at the University of Michigan was Don James, who went on to be very, very successful at the University of Washington. And Don actually coached, I believe, Warren Moon. So I have to admit that I've had some great, great coaches who taught me a lot about football and taught me a lot about myself.
And, Mike, you mentioned the couple of years you were in Detroit, and as I talked about in your intro, you're sort of forever linked with Garo Yepremian. And what most people probably don't know is that you guys played together when you were with
That's right.
the Lions, and you guys became friends. So sort of long before that play ever happened, you guys had played with one another. You mind sharing that story?
Yes. Well, Garo and I were with Detroit at the same time. He was going through many of the things that I was going through, complete and total frustration. And so we both jumped at the chance to get out of Detroit, who were, and that team, they were just perennial losers. And he went to Miami, and I went to Washington. And down through the years, during our playing time and even afterwards, we had maintained contact, and we were great friends. He was just a great, great man. Unfortunately, we lost him a year or so ago, and I do still miss him because I would talk with him several times during the course of the year, and just a great competitor and Garrow and I had done a number of engagements together. We'd done some Super Bowl work together. And, of course, we are joined at the hip because of that one play.
Mm-hmm. Questions for Mike?
Mike, it's a pleasure to speak with you again. You know, I have some great memories of those Redskin teams, which I'll get to in a minute. But this comes up on almost every show we do, Mike, as far as the all-around athlete, which you were in high school, football, basketball, track and field. And we see so many kids, and Chris can attest, so many kids these days specialize in just the one sport. They're focused on that one sport. I want to ask you, like I have in many other guests, your participation in the different sports, did that make you an overall better football player once you got to the NFL?
Oh, I think so. Every time you take on a different sport, you're using different senses, you're using different muscles, and overall, you can't help but have better development of your body in order to go through the rigors of playing professional football. But like you said, the playing different sports prepares you for a lot of different situations and circumstances, and you don't realize it at the time. And it does take some time to hone your skills, and you just can't do it, I don't think, in just playing one sport. And fortunately for us who played different sports, particularly in high school, it opens up the opportunities. Quite frankly, although I wasn't tall enough to be any decent basketball player, it helped with my quickness, it helped with my one-on-one challenges. And actually, during the summer, I was a catcher and got some interest from the Giants as a catcher. But these mm-hmm. things would never have materialized, or even I never would have even had the even inkling of an opportunity if I had not played these different sports. So I do think that it's a benefit. It really is a benefit, because if you're doing the same thing all the time, there is muscle fatigue. And when you're using the same muscles all the time, the other muscles are not getting used. So I do think it's important, and I think it helped me particularly when it came to making a roster and having to cover some of the best receivers that have ever played the game. I just was very, 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 very lucky. But after all, luck is really when preparation meets opportunity, and I really believe in that.
Mike, you mentioned George Allen. I think we talked a little bit last time about this man, and as much as a Hall of Famer could be underrated, I think he is as a coach. Here's a guy that never finished under 500. I think his worst year was 8-6. But you look at his record, it's just phenomenal. And I remember I was very young watching him with the Rams and then, of course, with the Redskins, but had so much enthusiasm, but it was a incredible innovator. I remember the spiritual advisor on the sideline. The guy was amazing. He did things his own way. Tell us a little bit more about some of the quirks about such a great coach.
Well, George, first of all, like Coach Lombardi, he loved his players. And more than that, he respected those players. And he gave us an opportunity to be ourselves and have some input. And your great coaches are coaches who know that they don't know everything. And when it came to the Redskins and his being the coach, he created that veteran team by bringing in many of the old Rams and exposing us to a type of football. The old Redskins, exposing us to a type of football that really we had never, ever experienced before. The emphasis was on defense. The emphasis was on team defense. The emphasis was on team. I see a lot of the teams now where the emphasis is on an individual player, the shutdown corner. You know, you have to ask yourself what happens when that shutdown corner is not able to shut down whoever he's supposed to shut down. And so having a team defense in which it's coordinated. And when you do have coordinated defenses, you don't necessarily have to have the quickest or the fastest or the best athletes. Having a veteran team, you don't have the mistakes that you normally would have as well. And I was one of the young fellows on the team, I believe at 27, 28, 29 years old. He made my career. I Coach Lombardi gave me the opportunity and pushed and gave me the confidence, but it was George Allen who taught me football.
We are talking with former Redskins All-Pro defensive back Mike Bass here on Thursday Night Tailgate. And Mike, just a couple more before we let you go. And you talked about, you know, the great coaches that had an opportunity to play for. But when you were with the Redskins, you played with a couple of guys who went on to become really good coaches in their own right, and guys like Richie Pettibone and Jack McCarthy. Talk about what it was like playing alongside those guys.
Well, again, we go back to the ability to Coach George Allen having the confidence to accept suggestions by veteran football players. Pardee was one. I played with Chris Hamburger. I played with Kenny Houston, Sonny Jurgensen, Sam Huff. These guys had an input into what we were doing, particularly Chris and Jack Pardee. I just can't thank them enough for giving us the benefit of their knowledge. And our defense was a very, very strong defense, and it was a defense that was predicated on turnovers. Fooling the quarterback, getting sacks, scoring on defense, all of these things contributed, and it was the team that won these games, not a particular individual. I don't consider myself a tremendous athlete. I never did. I was a part of that wheel that made everything work together. And I played right next to Kenny Houston and Brig Owens, and Chris Hamburger and I were all on the same side. And so when you play coordinated defenses, there are no weaknesses. If teams try to exploit what they consider a weakness, we had the opportunity to make adjustments, and that turned into one of our strengths against those teams. And if you ask any of the teams that we played against, I think they would really give you the same answer. It was tough. And, of course, we won. We won, and we had the camaraderie. I really wish that the players of today would consider doing a lot better for us, particularly the Players Association, than they've been doing. We went on strike several times in order for them to get, the current owners, to make $12, $13, $14 billion now a year, and we have some fellows who are getting $200, $300 in pension funds. It's a disgrace, but I guess that's the way it is under the circumstances. But we who really helped pioneer the game, we're not happy campers. But so they have their own consciences to worry about, not us.
Mike, before we let you go, remind our listeners how they're able to to follow you and perhaps stay in touch and watch the things that you're doing now.
Well, I have two websites. I've got a personal website, which is www.mikebass41.com. And I have a business website that is www.kimlou.com, which actually represents the names of my two daughters, Kimberly and Louise. I'm very, very proud of my daughters, but I managed to keep my feet wet. I'm 71 now, getting a little older, and I dabble around on the internet. I do some consulting work, and I'm just enjoying myself. And I stay in touch with a number of my teammates, and it's always good when we can get together. And when we do, the same conversations take place. We were a team. There is no I in team. And we respect the fact that we had two of the finest coaches that have ever lived, Vince Lombardi and George Allen.
Wow. Mike, it is so much fun, when we get to have you on the show. We hope you'll come back again soon, because so many more things we'd love to get your thoughts and your insights on, but we have really enjoyed, obviously our time with you tonight and the time that we got to spend with you a few months back. So we hope you'll keep it going and continue to come back and share your stories with us.
Well, I thank you very much for inviting me, and I have an opinion on everything. So maybe the next time discuss something else.
Absolutely. Mike, thanks again for your time tonight. All the best to you and your family. We look forward to the opportunity to catch up with you again.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you very much for having me again.
All right. Take care, Mike.
Take care.
That is former Redskins All-Pro defensive back Mike Bass. And boy, Bob, so many things to get in with Mike, but really enjoy getting to listen to him tell, share the stories. And obviously the theme of his stories tonight was team.
Oh, yeah, and how much he loved George Allen, and what an innovator. Again, I think he was one of the more underrated coaches ever. But, when you think of Mike Bass, you just think of those 70s, the Redskin teams from RFK, Chris. That's when I basically grew up on that kind of stuff, watching that era. And he was a great football player, and, he got his degree while he was at Michigan. And he went on to be a very successful businessman, teacher, et cetera. And you could tell just by the way he talks, has had a great life, and look forward to talking to him again soon.
Yeah, absolutely. And sincerely, folks, when you want to talk about some of the greatest, defensive backs of all time, you really need to check out all the things that Mike Bass did. 1971, 8 interceptions. He had interceptions in 4 consecutive games, as a matter of fact. So it's hard to find a defensive back that was any better than Mike Bass. All right, we've got our next guest hanging on the line, and he is now back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line a little bit later than his weekly time slot. That's just because we unfortunately had some extra time with Mike Bass, and I hope Tony will forgive us for running a little bit late. How are you tonight, Tony?
Hi, Tony.
How you guys doing? I'm doing fantastic.
That's good news. So, Tony, I want to get right into it. One of the things that Bob and I were talking about at the top of the show, and we're going to talk about this a little bit later tonight when Will Witherspoon joins us, but I wanted to get your perspective. When we look out at the legacies of Bill Belichick and Tom Brady, how much are the clouds of Deflategate and Spygate, do you think, are going to take away from the legacy and the things that they've accomplished?
I don't think it will take away at all, especially if you're a Patriot fan.
Well, of course not.
But I can't see that having a dark shadow over their legacy at all. I mean, one of the things that you have to look at with Brady and Belichick is all the winning seasons. One thing that I look at the most is how they did it, the way they did it. As far as the personnel, I mean, there's a lot of a lot of seasons where, you know, Brady didn't have the best offensive lineman. He didn't have the best receivers. Didn't have a running game. A lot of times, you back in the day, if you didn't have a running game, you weren't going to get to the Super Bowl. You weren't going to get to the Super Bowl without a great defense. And it was always, it seemed to be always something that we lacked. Every year that we had winning season, it was either we didn't have a running game, or we didn't have a great receiver, or we didn't have a great defense, or we didn't have a good offensive line, but we always win. And that's one of the things that you have to look at as a player, as somebody that, you know, who knows football and knows the ins and outs of football. You know, usually you got to have the whole package to get to the Super Bowl time and time again like they've done. So I really can't see it having too much of a shadow over their legacy, because the thing about Deflategate is, to me, it's really a joke. I mean, it really is to me, because quarterbacks have been doing that since I've been playing. You know, that's 30 years ago. I know Steve Grogan likes his balls a certain way, and that's how they did it. And, it's just how it was. This how it is. I truly believe that Tom Brady is such a great quarterback, and why would he try to do something as stupid as that? And I think it's stupid, as stupid as that, to put the balls down illegally for him to have an advantage. Of course, he's gonna do it how he likes the ball, and all quarterbacks have a different way. Some quarterbacks like their balls real hard. Some like them real soft, and so some like old balls. Some like new balls. It's just something that the league had to find, and the crazy thing about it is, when they realized, you know, what had happened, and they put the balls at the regular pound or whatever regular weight, they scored more points in the second half than they did the first half. So, you know, we'll figure that out. So, but I just can't see that having any type of shadow over the legacy of Brady and Belichick, all the winning seasons that they had. I just can't see it.
And Tony, when you were drafted in 1981, having come from, upstate New York, not that far from Buffalo, and we've talked about, you know, you're growing up and watching O.J. Simpson play and all of that. The Bills that season had back-to-back second-round picks. So they had the 49th and 50th pick the year you came out, 81. You were selected with the 47th overall pick. Were you at all hoping to still be available, you know, when the Bill picked, that maybe you'd have an opportunity to play back in front of, you know, folks that, you know, that you grew up with?
I would tell you, honestly, Chris, it was like, honestly, for me, I thought I was going to get drafted in the fourth or the fifth round. And, you know, so that's what my agent told me. That's what a lot of the pro scouts, I got looked at by Washington, the Redskins, a whole lot. I actually went and visited them a couple times, so I kind of thought that they were going to pick me up in the fourth or the fifth round that year. So I was really just looking towards the fourth or the fifth round. Of course, I was watching the draft, and, you know, it was pretty exciting watching the draft, because I went down to the combines and everything, and met some of all the great running backs and the great, you know, the linebackers that came out that year. It was a good draft with running backs and linebackers. Lawrence Taylor came out that year. EJ Jr. It was a bunch of good athletes. I think Drew McNeil came out that year as well. And when I was actually watching when the Patriots, right before the Patriots picked me, the camera goes to the Patriots table, and the guy at the Patriots table writes down the name Anthony Collins, and I was like, is there another Anthony Collins in this draft? that's exactly how it happened. And as soon as I said that, I get the phone call from the Patriots and being drafted in the second round. I had no idea I was going to get drafted that high. I really didn't. Wow. And so it was pretty exciting. But to be honest with you, I don't care what team drafted me. I just wanted to get drafted.
Bob, questions for Tony?
Hey, Tony, I wanted to talk to you tonight about all the work you do with youngsters. And there's such a fine line, Tony, about kids and their dreams and what they want to do as far as athletically. Because when you're talking to youngsters, Tony, it's pretty much to them, it's all about athletics. You know, I'm going to be that next Tony Collins. I'm going to be that next guy that can make it to the pros. And you have to kind of walk a fine line because you got to be straight with these guys, but you don't want to totally discourage them. I mean, it's tough, you know. And I talked to a local coach the other day, Tony. He coaches baseball here. And there's actually a sign that some of the parents and coaches came up with in this town. It went along the lines of, your kid is not going to be the next Mike Trout. Your kid is not going to probably get a scholarship. Don't live through your kid and enjoy the game. It was something along those lines. I thought in a way it was good. In a way, you know, you don't want to discourage kids. But when you talk to these kids, Tony, it must be you have to probably put the emphasis on more on education than this kid's going to be the next NFL running back.
Oh, absolutely. One of the things that I relate to the kids, especially if I'm talking to a bunch of athletes, one of the ways that recruiters and coaches look at athletes is that, you know, if you got two kids that run a 4.5 40, okay, both kids run a 4.5 40, both have the same almost athletic ability. What the coaches and what the recruiters are going to go after next, well, that, not next, but the thing that they're looking at is now the character in that kid. And how they judge the character of that kid is how high is his GPA. So if one of those kids that run a 4.5 40 has a 3.2 grade point average and the other kid has a 2.8 grade point average, they're going after the 3.2 grade point average every single time. And that's that's one of the things that I try to relate to these athletes, is that your education is almost as more important than your 40 time. Because if you have a 4.0 grade point average, these coaches and these recruiters, they're thinking this kid has character because he keeps his grades up. And if I got a kid that runs a 4.5 40, and I got another kid that runs a 4.6 40, just a little bit slower, but that kid that has that 4.6 40 has a 4.0 grade point average, this kid has character, and I'm going after him. I can get him faster. I can't do anything so much to maybe to help his character, but I can get him faster. But now he already has the character level that we want. And so that's the type of thing that we relate to these kids. Now, there's going to be athletes that have great athletic ability, I mean super athletic ability, and if they have a 1.8 grade point average, and I tell them all the time, you can run a 4.3 40, and we love speed, man, but if you have a 1.8 grade point average, all you're going to be is fast, and you're not going anywhere. And so it's so important that they understand that part of it, because if they don't understand, and a lot of kids think, well, I'm a great athlete, so everybody in the country is going to be after me. Well, if your grades aren't up to par, you're going to have to go to JUCO, you're going to have to take the long route, and you might not make it because of your grades. And so it's so important that they understand that part. And at the same time, I tell my story to them and let them know, man, you know, If I can come from a family of 16 in a small town, and, you know, nobody figured that, you know, nobody from my high school has ever gone on and played in the NFL. All my brothers tried, none of them made it, but I believe that I could make it. You know, if you have the athletic ability and you work your butt off and you do the things that you're supposed to do, you make good choices, I mean, it's out there for you. But the most important thing right now is that you make sure that you get your grades up, because that's how you're going to get that scholarship. That's how you're going to pave your way to let these recruiters to go after you because they think, plus they don't know how, what your character is like, and how they judge character now is how high a kid's GPA is.
And speaking about character and things like that, I almost hate to bring this up, Tony, but it's newsworthy, and you're as good as any to talk about it. The Johnny Manziel thing, Tuesday he comes out and says, I'm going to start cleaning up my act on Friday. He puts conditions on it. You still must be concerned with this guy, Tony, and I'm at the point now where it used to be, you know, you got angry, you got silly about it. Now you almost are feeling sad for this guy. What's going on in his life?
Yeah, it is. It is sad, Bob. I tell you, man, you know, a kid like that, you know, I watched him in college, and, you know, he reminded me a lot of Doug Flutie, you know, how, you know, the way he did things. But, and then, you know, you hear some of the stuff that was going on off the field, and you're hoping that, you know, he could turn this thing around. But it just seems like that he's not able to do it on his own, and I think most importantly right now he needs to get his life straightened out. Football is a game, and you know he can get out there, man, and just do something stupid, have an incident, and his life can be taken away from him. So it's really sad, man. You know, you see guys all the time who would love to be in his position. I mean, great people, great guys, work hard, but don't have the athletic ability that he has, or the chances or the opportunity that he has. And he's just all that talent that God has given him. You know, he's just dwindling away, and it's really sad. You know, it's really sad, and you think about, you know, what. What is it? You know, I mean, why is it like that? You know, there's a few things. You know, his surroundings, people that he's surrounding himself with, just the choices that he's making, and I'm almost at a point now that I don't think he understands how big the NFL is to a 9-year-old, to a 10-year-old. As for me, when I was a 9-year-old, the NFL was like, man, if I could just make it to the NFL, man, this would be just the best thing that ever could ever happen to me and my family. And I think he's really just taking the NFL for granted. And almost now he's taking his life for granted. And it's really, really sad to see what he's going through. And hopefully he can get some help, man. It's not too late, man. You know, you're not dead, so he still has the opportunity to turn this thing around. And so, you know, I'm just hoping for the best for the kid, and hopefully he can get it turned around. Hopefully he can, you know, meet someone, because really, to be honest with you, man, and the same thing that happened to me, it took one person, you know, to kind of change my way of thinking. And hopefully, you know, God will put somebody in his path to help him change his way of thinking, because that's where it seems like it's gonna take I don't want nothing bad to happen to him, but it's almost at a point now that maybe something bad has to happen to him for him to turn his life around. But yeah, you don't want it to happen that way, and so maybe I'm believing that a person will come in his life, and you know that kind of see, you know, he can see that, you know, this is not the route to go, and just somebody needs to get with him. And I know his dad is trying to help, and it just seems like he's not listening. So hopefully he'll start listening real soon.
Tony, before we let you go, remind our listeners how they can follow you online, over social media, and all the great things you're doing.
TonyCollinsProjects.com and TonyCollinsFoundation.com. We just had our tournament this past Monday up in the New England area. It was a complete success, man. All the guys came out, Steve Brogan and Ronnie Lepet, Roland James. We had a great turnout of Patriot players and a few other celebrities in the area. It was fantastic. I, for the very first one, you always want the first one to be a good one. You want the golfers to enjoy it, and they did. They got great feedback, and they can't wait for next year. And And try to get Bob, you and Chris to come up as one of my celebrities next year. So we'll see what
we
can do about that.
We appreciate that very much.
I got two more tournaments coming up in July. So I'm all excited. Things are going great. We're giving out money to these kids and helping these kids get into college. And I just got through talking to a kid today, man. I got to share this with you. He was the last one to earn the scholarship, and I talked to him today, and he got on the phone, and he got choked up, man. He was so happy, and it's a kid that's going to a community college, you know, so he's really so excited about it, and. Man, it almost brought tears to my eyes. So he couldn't stop thinking me, couldn't stop thinking the program. And so those are the things that's real touching to me, to see these kids really excited about their future and going off to college, man. So his life is great, man. Man, God is good, and I'm just living the dream right now.
That's fantastic. That's what it's all about, my friend. Tony, thank you so much for joining us again this week. Always one of the best segments of the show is getting to spend time with you. And like we say a lot, you leave Bob and I with smiles on our faces. So we can't thank you enough for being a part of the show and the great things you're doing, Tony.
Thank you guys for what you guys do too, man. You guys do a great job. Thanks a lot. Appreciate it.
Thank you,
Tony. All the best to you and your family, my friend. We'll catch up again soon.
Yes, sir.
Take care.
That is former Patriots Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins, and you want to talk about spotlight on the positive, Bob? It doesn't get a lot better than the great things Tony is doing for kids all over the place, getting them into college, or at least helping to pay for college.
Yeah, and it seems like our conversations always turn from his days in the football field, and you can see it in his voice, Chris, and his vocation that he's just so devoted to making people's lives better. It always gravitates in that fashion, and he knows what's important in life, and we're very, very lucky to be treated to that on a weekly basis.
That's exactly right. All right, we've got our next guest, Dr. Stephen Novicky, who's been very patient with us and hanging on the line. We're going to get to Doc on the other side of this station identification.
Hi, this is former Rams QB Jim Everett, and you're listening to Thursday Night Tailgate, a.k.a. TNT. And it's explosive in here with my buddies, the hosts, Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari. And we're listening to all this on the Armed Forces Radio Network. So take it away, Ben.
And now back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line is Dr. Stephen Novicky. Doc has been a great friend of the show since very early on. This is his fifth appearance with us, and you've heard us say for years that organized leagues everywhere need to do more with helmet safety, particularly helmet-to-helmet contact. And Doc's product, ShockStrips, is something that can do just that. He's had some great advances with his product since he originally joined us a few years ago, and he continues to find new ways to improve it all the time. And we're very excited that he was patient with us, and he's back with us again tonight here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Good evening, Doc, Chris, and Bob. Thanks for coming back on the show.
Hey, Doc.
Chris and Bob, hey, how are you guys? Thanks for having me back, and you guys are always worth the wait, so never mind.
I appreciate
great,
you, Doc.
Thanks.
So, Doc, I was, back out there checking on your site over the last couple of weeks, and I have to say to folks, the folks in your home state and Ohio continue to do a great job embracing the product. You got 25 teams throughout the state using ShockStrips. I see teams now in Arkansas, in Iowa, Indiana, Massachusetts, New York, Pennsylvania, Texas, Virginia, the state of Washington, all using it as well. So talk about the growth of the product and, how we can get, some of my southern states around here on board.
Well, it's getting pretty crazy, and we've had a phenomenal season again. I'd like to say that with the latest thing that's happening on my end is I am the 3-year comparative study that I did where one of the local high school teams, we had their team wear for 3 years. And then we took those stats for 3 years and we compared them with the team 3 years prior to them who did not wear the device. And that is that study is getting ready to get peer reviewed, or actually it's getting peer reviewed as we speak and everything. And I'm glad to say, I wish I could tell you guys the exact outcomes, but the study, not surprisingly, dictates that this needs to be used on a larger mass of people. And for the people who are concerned about the validity of it, It's this paper says it needs to be tested on more teams or more kids, because we are getting more kids wearing it across the state, and it is taking off. And so it's been pretty fabulous and phenomenal. And a lot of that I thank you guys for, because you've always been big supporters of ShockStrip.
So, you know, Doc, you know, I mean, and hopefully you'll come back on when, you know, when you're able to talk, you know, in more detail, you know, about what the study finds. But, you know, talk about some of the testimonials that you've received from football coaches, you know, again, around the country that have adopted the product.
Oh, it's amazing. I mean, the best one to date is I had a dad call me, and his son had several issues with helmet-to-helmet impacts, and he was thinking about giving up his senior year. And one of the big problems was he was having a lot of, problems with the situation. Even just before he was taking a lot, there was just issues with it. And he thought about quitting his senior year. And the dad buys a set of them for his son. And I said, look, I said, I can't promise you anything, but please call me on Friday night and let me know what happens. Well, it's 9 o'clock, it's 10 o'clock, it's 11 o'clock, it's 11:30. And I'm getting nervous now on a Friday night, 11:30, going, this guy didn't call me. Did something happen? Well, he calls me up at about 11:45, and he's crying. And I'm like, oh, my gosh. I'm, like, freaking out because I'm going, did something bad happen to this kid with these on? And he was crying because they had just spent the last 2.5 hours after the game with the family. They were so thrilled because he said his son was really worried that he wasn't going to be able to play his senior year. And after the first series, he could see his son taking some pretty heavy impacts and that, and he thought he was going to come off the field and wave it off and say, I'm done, no more. My head's not going to take this anymore. And I guess the dad said he came off the field, he lifted up his helmet, and he had a big smile on his face, and he gave him a big thumbs up. So here I am. He's crying. Now I got tears running down my face. So, but it's you know, because first of all, it was tears of happiness for him and tears of relief for me, because I'm thinking, oh, my gosh, something happened. But, no, we've gotten lots of the coaches are just – they're amazed. And they the biggest thing I hear now is I'm glad I'm not that worried about or wasn't that worried about the warranty on the helmet, because a lot of the coaches and the parents are looking at it is they're looking at the warranty. And the warranty, as I've always told you guys before, has no liability value. So it doesn't really do anything as far as safety concern for the patient. If the helmet cracks, my company replaces it. If you have an issue with the mask, we'll replace it. We have no problem with that. So you're seeing a lot of coaches and parents out there saying, you know what, the device works. We're not concerned about a warranty, and we're going to keep wearing it. And like I said, the testimonials, I could sit here for an hour and talk to you about them. It's been phenomenal. It's overwhelming. Another great one. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No. Go ahead, please.
I was in Florida, and I had a ShockStrip windbreaker on, and I'm in Clearwater Beach, Florida, and where nobody, I figured, knows what ShockStrip is. And a dad walks up to me, and he goes, hey, is that ShockStrip? Is that the thing that my son wears on his helmet? And I said, yes, sir. And he asked me a couple of questions, and I answered him and everything. And the guy never asked me who I was or what I was with the company or anything. And he walks away, and he comes back about 10 minutes later, and he goes, hey, you're Dr. Novicky. You're the guy who invented this. He goes, why didn't you tell me who you were? And I said, because it's not about me. It's about the kids and the players. And he goes, I got to tell you something. He goes, my wife and I were not going to let our son play. And when we bought these and put them on his helmet, we weren't looking for miracles. We were just looking for a little bit more safety. And he said, our son plays with so much confidence now, and it's been such a confidence builder for him to get out and play football, because that's football is. It's a confidence builder, and it's a camaraderie. And they said before he played football, he was really shy, and now he's starting to come out of his shell. And they said, you know, they just wanted to thank me. So that was probably one of the dad crying was the best one, but that was probably the second best one, because that was live. So I really appreciated that. So it's been great.
Yeah, no, that's fantastic. And, you know, and Doc, for people that are listening in that aren't, you know, familiar with the product, what are you guys talking about? Talk about, you know, give a quick overview of what ShockStrips are.
What ShockStrips are strips of a polymer that goes on the outside of the helmet. There's seven of them. So there's one down the center, then one on each side, two in the back, and then two go oblique or at angles down the side. And they're in the most vulnerable areas of where the helmet takes the helmet-to-helmet impacts. And they're basically a padding on the outside of the helmet that reduces the impact. It reduces the torque on the neck. And we've also seen that where it actually increases the duration of the impact, meaning the helmet companies used to want a cue ball effect where they were bouncing off of each other. And through testing with ShockStrip on, we've kind of actually found that was dangerous, because we've learned through testing that the longer the duration of the impact, of the strips, the less forces on the that the football player's neck take. So ultimately what it is it's a great device for the outside to have on your kids if you're going to let them – outside of the helmet if you're going to let them play football.
There you go.
That's summing up pretty good.
That's great. Bob, questions for Doc?
And, Doc, I have to give you so much credit because I know you got into this because of the serious nature of it. And I was looking at some of the numbers that had been thrown out there in previous articles. Starting in the late 90s, for a 15-year stretch, there was almost a half million kids were taken to ERs with concussions. And I think the average age, Doc, was about 15. To me, and that's just the ones that were reported, at the age of 15, and you figure if these kids probably had a couple more concussions by the time they hit 18, Doc, isn't that kind of devastating? I mean, for a growing young man or girl, I mean, at the age of 15 to have one and then maybe another before 18, I mean, this is beyond serious to me.
Well, you're exactly right. It is a problem because the brain doesn't fully develop until the age of 22. So these young athletes, their brains are still developing. So when they're taking that impact, they've shown some studies that they are healing. But again, we don't know to the intensity of the impact that was taken to the intensity that they're healing. So there's always the probability of scar tissue in that brain somewhere. And ultimately, the child and the athlete are going to pay the price for it. And you're right, it is sad, and it has become an epidemic because I believe, don't quote me on the number, but I believe switching gears to the NFL real quick, I believe there was like 81 to 95 more concussions this year than last year, and the NFL said half of their concussions were due to helmet-to-helmet impacts. So it's sad that it's starting at such a young age, and it's even getting worse at the pro level.
And speaking, in addition to the shock strips, Doc, how important is a helmet fit to a young football player? And do you have a lot of impact into that?
Well, it's key. The proper fitting helmet is one of the things that you can do to reduce the probability of a concussion from a helmet-to-helmet impact. And that's why we tell the kids, we try to tell them not to wear dew caps. We try to tell them to get their hair cut shorter so that the helmet conforms to their head a lot better, and that's going to prevent or reduce a lot of the problem with the properly fitted helmet.
So, Doc, for folks that are listening in that may not have a son or daughter that are playing football but might be playing other sports like hockey, you know, shock strips can be used, for hockey and to help, protect the kids that play that and other sports as well, right?
Exactly. They'll go on hockey helmets. They'll go on lacrosse helmets. They'll go on bicycle helmets. They'll go on motorcycle helmets. And that was another thing I was going to bring up with you guys, and I'm proud that our engineers have really – they've had a great winter because we're going through or have gone through the redesign process. So it looks a little more modern than what it was last year. And, yes, it can retrofit onto a lot of helmets out there to protect all kids in all sports.
And for people that look at the shock strips and wonder about, friction, could they cause, other helmets to potentially, if they're, if you got two helmets with shock strips on them and they, rub up against each other and all that sort of stuff that we'd be concerned with respect to, like I say, with respect to friction and or other things, there's no danger to that, right? And that's something you guys, looked into as well?
Well, yes, we did. That was one of our biggest concerns because, as I said earlier, the helmet companies used to want the helmets to bounce off of each other, and they called it a cue ball effect. Well, we found through the testing that the helmets staying together a little bit longer is beneficial for the athlete's cervical spine. So we found that the shock strips, actually the coefficient of friction or that little bit of a friction that's there with it, was actually better than the alleged cue ball effect that they were looking for.
And Doctor, remind our listeners again, with respect to, some of the tests that you've done, when I looked over some of the testing results you have on your site from previous tests, with products with straight line linear testing and that sort of thing. If you with one helmet with shock strips, you decrease, by a certain percentage. If you have both helmets that come together, they're using shock strips, it gets even better. Talk about, the percentages involved and how much, the acceleration and that sort of thing decreases when you're using the product.
Well, the total, the highest testing, the best testing we found is it was up to a 44% reduction of the impact and 12.85% on the angular acceleration. And the angular acceleration is the rotatory or rotation component of when a player gets hit from the side. Front on or direct impacts are bad, but they're not as bad as when the player actually gets hit from an angle and his head starts torquing. And we've seen some decent numbers with ShockStrip with the decrease of that angular acceleration. So we're really happy about that, and that we're really looking forward to seeing more players wearing it because of the reduction in the angular acceleration.
So, Doc, one more before we let you go. And you know, we got introduced to you and your product through a mutual good friend, which you heard during the station ID, our friend Jim Everett. So, curious for you to retell the story. How did you two get hooked up?
Well, first of all, I loved it when I heard Jim's voice. Actually, Jim called me when I was on vacation one year, and I was on the beach, and I see a call from California coming in. And for some reason, I never answer a call that doesn't have a name or isn't in my directory. And a buddy of mine says, answer the call. So I answer it, and he introduces himself and says, hello, this is Jim Everett, and I'd like to talk to Dr. Novicky. And actually, I thought it was some friends of mine that were messing with me. So I'm kind of like going, yeah, right, sure, okay. And what I eventually did was, is I said, okay, I'm going to ask you a question real quick. You have to answer it real quick. If you don't answer it real quick, then I know it's not you. And I asked him who the football teams were that he was a quarterback for. And obviously he spit them out pretty quick. And at that point I knew it was Jim Everett. And we've been pretty great friends ever since. We were laughing about the whole thing. And he's been a huge supporter of it. And it's always great to have somebody of his caliber as an ex-NFL quarterback supporting ShockStrip.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Jimmy's great. Doc, before we let you go, let our listeners know about how they're able to, take a look at the product and check out all the information and the details you have, and then follow you as well on social media.
Okay, you can find me at ShockStrip on Twitter. You can find ShockStrip at ShockStrip@ZoomInternet.net. And we're getting ready to revamp some of the website and everything. So if you go on and you have a little bit of trouble getting on it, that's okay. Just work with us here because we're doing a lot of great things to it. So anytime anybody needs to get a hold of me, they can always get a hold of me through either the website or social media. And I'm always willing to talk to any coaches, parents, players, whoever. We're out here just trying to protect the player and make the game safer. If I could say one more thing real quick. It was a little disturbing to me is that I live in Canfield, Ohio, and there was a message on Facebook, and it basically said from one of the coaches that if we don't get enough kids, we're not going to field a freshman football team this year. And that kind of blew me away because this is a really, really good football team. Coach Pavlovsky is a great football coach, and here's a team that's a pretty good team looking at not being able to put a freshman football team out there. And if you don't have freshman football players, what do you have? You don't have seniors eventually. So it's sad that when I saw that on Facebook, I was like, the game is deteriorating. And Bob, you said it earlier, this is getting worse and worse and worse, and it's not getting better, and it's not looking like it's getting better. So I'm just fortunate to all the players across the country and the coaches and both you and Chris supporting ShockStrip. And I thank you guys very much for that.
Doc, you know, we're big fans of the product. We've been saying, you know, ever since we first met you that, you know, that the ShockStrip should be on every helmet. It doesn't make any sense to me why they're not. You know, we got to get this all the way up, you know, from the NFL level all the way down to the Pee Wee leagues, because it just makes sense. I mean, if you're going to, you know, reduce the, you know, the level of impact on helmet to helmet contact, why wouldn't you? And, you know, hopefully, you know, more and more schools and more teams start to embrace it and, first of all, check it out and understand what it is and how it works. And then, you know, start to embrace the product and wear it, because this is a win-win for everybody. Why wouldn't you want to reduce the level of impact on helmets if you could? We do a lot of things with all the other pads and the rules and that sort of thing. Let's start addressing the helmet and putting pads and cushions on the exterior of the helmet. Just makes sense. So hopefully we'll see the product continue to grow and prosper, because it's fantastic.
Well, thank you guys very much. And we are the teams, the parents, the players, the coaches, they're, like I said, they're starting to look and say, you know what, we're not getting anywhere with the evolution of the helmet, so we're going to take it in our own hands to use something out there that's shown. It's been on the field for 5 years and over 12,500 games. We've never had any major somebody call us up and say, hey, we had a major problem with it, or nothing. So it's field tested, it's lab tested, we've got a paper written about it, a lot of great things happening. And again, thank you guys so very much. I appreciate everything you've done for me.
Doc, we can't thank you enough for coming back on the show. We hope you'll come back again soon with some more good news. And like I say, when you've got the data to share, we want to be able to help you share it. So hopefully that takes place real soon. But in between now and then, thank you for being here tonight, and all the best to you and to Cindy and everybody over at ShockStrip.
Thanks. I appreciate it.
Take care.
All right, take care, Doc.
Take care, guys. Bye-bye.
That is Dr. Stephen Novicky of ShockStrip. Again, you know, we can't say it enough. It's a no-brainer to me. These things belong on every single helmet and every single level to help protect players of every age, Bob. It just doesn't make sense to me why we're not seeing this, you know, just grow rapidly. It's been a steady growth over the few years that we've had Doc on the show. It needs to grow exponentially quicker.
I can't agree more. We talked about it last time, Chris. No matter if it's 44% less or 4%, it doesn't matter. They need to be on the helmets. And I think he made a great point. Between a good fit, which, you know, they're not – these high school coaches, high school programs probably aren't doing as well as they should with the fit of helmets. Between good fits and the shock strips, the injuries just have to go down. And that's what you – that we need to see it in a lot more places just in high schools.
Yeah, absolutely right. All right, we've got our next guest, Will Witherspoon, hanging on the line. We're going to get to Will on the other side of this station identification.
This is Reggie Kelly, former Cincinnati Bengals and Atlanta Falcons tight end, and you're listening to TNT, Thursday Night Tailgate. Brace yourself for the explosion.
And now back with us and making his fourth appearance on the Kyven Foods guest line is Will Witherspoon. Let me remind you about Will's background. He's from San Antonio, Texas. And for our listeners on the Armed Forces Radio Network, Will's father served for many years in the U.S. Air Force. As a senior in high school, Will was named the Florida Player of the Year by the USA Today. He played his college ball at the University of Georgia, where he was a three-year starter, including every game as a true freshman. He was a third-round pick by the Carolina Panthers in 2002, and he played linebacker in the NFL from 2002 to 2013 for the Panthers, Rams, Eagles, and Titans. After retiring from the game, he's been a sideline reporter for ESPN Radio 104.5 over in St. Louis. He is also the owner of Shiregate Farm, which I can tell you from experience sells some of the best beef products that you'll eat anywhere. You got to check them out online at shiregatefarm.com. And we're very excited that Will is back with us again tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Will, Chris and Bob, thanks for coming back on the show.
Hey, Will.
Yeah, man, anytime. You guys, how are things going?
Good? Really well, thank you.
So really good. I'm glad, Will, you guys can hear me. I'm actually standing out here at the farm right now.
Is that right? So how that's going to start right there. How are things going at the farm?
Good, good. You know, getting everybody here for the 4th of July party and having a good time and getting the campfire going, getting ready to start that up before we start roasting some hot dogs tonight and marshmallows and stuff like that. And
good for you.
You know, just good times. Good times.
Good for you. So, Will, I wanted to start tonight with with your alma mater, the University of Georgia. Kind of wanted to get your thoughts on the Bulldogs. What you as you look ahead to their first season under Kirby Smart, what are your expectations?
Oh man, I'm definitely looking forward to it. You know, to see the changes that Kirby's going to bring. No disrespect to Coach Rick, because I had him as a coach, and I think he's a great coach as well. I think it's just the time had come for him to move on and do what he needed to do. And the change, I think that the dynamic change of it all, of having Kirby move in, who's a guy I played alongside Kirby, so it's been kind of this sweet circle of things that I've gotten to see. So. I'm looking forward to seeing what he brings to the table, because Kirby's honestly one of the smartest guys I've played alongside in my career in total. So I know he understands the game. I know he knows how to teach the game well, and I'm looking forward to seeing what he does, with the Bulldogs this year.
And Will, you posted a video of all the Super Bowl MVPs that have come out of Georgia. And as a Steelers fan, I love and appreciate Hines Ward. There's also, Terrell Davis and Jake Scott, plus, there's been a ton of talent
that has come out of the University of Georgia. It seems like year after year after year, yet the program hasn't been able to get over the top and, you know, play for a national championship in the last 35 years. As you see, you know, Kirby Smart taking over, is there a missing ingredient that you think he's going to be able to put in place that is going to get Georgia over the top?
You know, I think it's going to take him maybe a year or two to really get all his pieces in line. You know how it is when there's a transition, but I think he's got all the pieces there. It's just to get those guys to fall into the understanding of what he brings to the table, what kind of coach he is, making sure they understand his system. That's where I think the question is how quickly guys take hold of that and make it their own, make it their mission. So when he gets that settled in, I think we're going to see a big shift in there. And of course, we already know the SEC has got its own, you know, got its own time frame. It's got its own cycle that happens within it, and I think it's about that time.
Bob, questions for Will?
Hey, Will, it's great to speak with you again. We, you know, I think of your introduction to the league. When you came in, you played under John Fox, and prior to Fox going to Carolina, he was big up here in New York as a defensive guy, Will, and always known as a defensive coach. How was he as a head coach, and how did he treat you as soon as you got into the league?
You know, Coach Fox is still one of the best coaches that I could have had coming into the league, right? It's for me, at least, right? That I think he was a coach who did a great job of delegating things to the right staff members, having those guys in place. You know, I had Sam Mills as a linebacker coach, Jack Del Rio as my defensive coordinator. And, you know, I look at that and go, just those two pieces alone kind of make a great statement. But beyond that, I think he did a great job of just pushing you to the limits. I mean, a lot of people really need to understand Coach Fox's background to really understand where he gets that from. That's a family trait, right? And he knows how to push guys to the edge and try and make you say, look, this is what it takes to get there. But the other side of this is, if you want to stay here, we all got to be on the same page together. And I think he did a great job of pulling our team together to commit to one another, not just what we need to do as a player to make it in this game, but to commit to the other players, your other teammates, and be sure that you were on the same page all the time. Like I think I said it before, you know, it's one of those things where you don't do two jobs on the field. So don't try and get two paychecks. So don't try and do that twice. Just do your job. I think he did a great job of putting that forward. And I think him going to Chicago, you know, matter of fact, I was just up there a couple of weeks ago speaking with him. But him going to Chicago, I think, is a great thing.
And, Will, we also think of a guy like Jeff Fisher as a good defensive, solid defensive mind, good coach. You played for him both in St. Louis and Tennessee. Share with us the differences or similarities between him and Fox.
Again, two coaches who are worth do their own weight in gold in delegation. They aren't afraid to let their coaches coach, right? They have their style. They have their understanding. They're going to know the systems, but they're not afraid to let the coaches coach. And Fish was another great prime example of that. You know, of course, in Tennessee and when I had him here in St. Louis, I think he's got an even bigger challenge ahead of him right now with just trying to get over this hump with the team moving to L.A., transitioning, getting guys settled in and making sure they understand that, you know, yeah, things are going to be a little off for the time being, but going forward, that's not going to change anything about who we are. That's not going to change who this team is or what we want to accomplish.
Well, I came across an interview you did with Pro Football Talk and NBC Sports last September where you said you and some of your teammates think that the Patriots perhaps might have cheated prior to Super Bowl 38 by videotaping some of your practices. And just to level set everyone, Super Bowl 38 took place back in February 1st in 2004, and the Spygate incident didn't come to light until 2007. So this obviously would have predated that. So, Will, was there something specific that happened that, you know, sort of made you guys wonder and shake your head that, you know, the Patriots had to have videotaped us to know this?
Well, there's certain things that we put in place. You know, every team does it. You come up with new game plans, new schemes, new things you try and do, not just week to week, but when you're playing in a game like the Super Bowl, you've got 2 weeks to prepare. Let's go ahead and do this. So things that you've never done all season. And, of course, with a team like we were at the time, I mean, you look at it across the board, pretty much every position on the field, we were basically interchangeable one way or another. It didn't didn't matter. I mean, Dan and I were, you know, especially in the linebacker position, Dan and myself could go to either side. We'd slide or move or do anything else. We wouldn't worry about that kind of thing. So as a team, that's who we were. We had this ability to kind of move around. I mean, you got Pep in there. You've got Mike Rucker, Mike Minner, everybody in there. So everything was kind of interchangeable with us. So there were some things that we put in the game plan that we had never done. And to see an immediate calm kind of reaction to knowing what was going on, talking about where the pressure's coming from, who's coming, like there were some things that you made you question it. I know, you know, Brinson Buckner and myself have talked about it a couple times because he's listening to it right on the nose of the ball. And we got to a point where we just was like, forget it. We're not trying to push anything else. Let's just do it and get back to what we do and play ball.
Mm-hmm. So in your mind, is there a cloud of doubt and a lack of integrity that's going to hang over Bill Belichick and Tom Brady's legacy based on sort of all the scandals, if you will, that they've been involved with?
You know, there's two things I totally have to give both of them a level of respect to. Tom Brady knows how to play quarterback in this game, knows what to do, knows how to do things. Is there ever going to be an asterisk or a question about whether or not he did it completely the right way? Who knows? But you also switch that around and look at, you know, Bill Belichick and go, this is the coach who went, you know, who always, I think, tries to set what the limit should be. So as a coach, great approach, gets players to buy in, does exactly what he is. You can't doubt his record in that point. So I think, yeah, is there going to be maybe some people put asterisks next to it and go, but what about this and this and this? Yeah, at the end of the day, we can't go back and play those games again. So, you know, there's a point where it's just – it's not worth Pete Rosen, the guy, you know?
Bob, one more for Will before we let him go.
Sure, Will. I mean, you've been out of the league a couple years, 3 years now, and to me, it seems like you've made – a very smooth transition to the quote-unquote civilian life. We talk to a lot of guys and hear a lot about guys that have a lot of trouble having played football for so long since they were, my goodness, 9-10 years old up until the age of 30, 35, transitioning. You don't seem to me to have had that big of a problem. Is that go back to your education? What was stressed to you as a youth? Because you seem to be incredibly in good shape right now and very, very literate and, of course, very successful.
Well, you know, part of it is, you know, instilled by my parents. Like, that was one thing. Like, they always made this moment of football a game. It was never the focal point of my life, right? Like, it was my job, and that was understood. It was the part I enjoyed. It was the, you know, they kept it as a game for me when I was a kid, and they never stressed the fact that you have to do this to be here, to get there. This is what makes you the next great. Like, we never had that question. So when I look at it, you know, that was a part of it. And of course, they've always stressed me to do more and be outside the box. And so I've always been a kid who, even as a kid, it was like, well, I'm going to do this and this and that and this. And so that's why, you know, when I ventured out into business in different ways, like my first business was doggy daycare in Charlotte. I mean, that's still great. You know, Four Paws is doing a great thing there. You know, I've ventured into a couple of things that I was testing the water in, you know, whether it was real estate at the time and, you know, or whether it was just, you know, what I want to do in the restaurant, if I want to ever get into a restaurant and do that, like kind of dabbing in very light levels just so I can look under the hood of things. So that was the part that helped me, I think, transition is I looked at things from the standpoint of, do I want to do this? Let me find out a little bit more about it. Do my research. Take the time. Do those kinds of things. You know, the farm was the same way. The farm is something that I started because I have a passion for it. I enjoy it. You know, it's fun for the family, and it's great for me to, you know, just take my time and enjoy that. But at the same time, you know, if I didn't want to do it, I wouldn't do it. And if I didn't see the truth of how it's affected my life and been part of my life, I wouldn't do it.
And, Will, you know, before we let you go, I saw that you're also doing some things now with Farmers Insurance, speaking of farms.
Yeah, definitely. Of course, when I knew I wasn't going to make that transition out to L.A., I've got kind of just too many things going on in St. Louis and with the farm here and, you know, kids are here and everything else going on, I started deciding what else I could do to help people. Like, you know, everything, I think every business I really found myself invested in is because I either am enjoying not just what it brings to the table, but it's a way to help people get across, you know, get over something, get through something. You know, the farm is helping people put great beef on their table, great foods on their table. We've now moved into some poultry as well, you know, doing the eggs and stuff like that. But, you know, and now with farmers, it allows me to do the same thing. It allows me to, you know, help people not only protect, but plan for their life, like plan life out and do many of the things that you'd need to do. I mean, I hate to say it, but insurance is like a needed, you know, necessary evil, as they like to say. And a lot of people shoot and say, we want the least amount of coverage for the least amount of money and the least amount of pocket and all these kind of things. Well, there's ways to get great coverage and do good things without putting yourself at risk. That's the biggest part that I see. And I've done it for years. You know, I've had things that happen to me and I'm like, wow, thank God I got this. But, you know, that's where I got involved in it, because it saw it as not only another way to keep myself, you know, moving forward and busy, and I enjoyed like working. So it's one of those things that is great there, but it allows me to, you know, get out and with people and help a lot of people, as well as help people get some direction about how I can help them not only plan for today, but work for the future as well.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's always such, you know, a great time. We get to spend a few minutes with you, and we really enjoy the opportunity to have you as part of the show. Let our listeners know, how can they follow you, whether it's, you know, online or over social media as well?
Well, I mean, you can always follow me. I've decidedly, I'm trying to, you guys are going to love this. I'm trying to decide if I want to do like a weekly blog or a vlog, maybe even. That's going to be one that I'll let you know, but it'll be a little entertainment. I'll keep you up to date on that. But I definitely want to get more active in my social media and doing more things like that, so people get to understand that. You'll probably see plenty of pictures of kind of what's going on this weekend out of the farm, of course, because this is actually Shiregate's 10th anniversary. So 10 years we've been at this. So it's a special 4th of July for everyone here. And, you know, of course, when working in the insurance world, that's all there. But you can find me at Will Witherspoon on Twitter, Will Witherspoon on Instagram. You can follow the farm at Shiregate Farm, or you can go to www.shiregatefarm.com. So there's a lot of things happening there, a lot of great things that I'm working on, tooling over and changing over and moving in the right direction as well.
Well, Will, you know, when you're ready to make those announcements, we hope you'll come back on the show and share those with us and our audience as well. You know, we've really, you know, enjoyed the, you know, like I say, the opportunity to get to know you over the years. And Shiregate Farm is fantastic. You know, it's a product that you know, several of our listeners have tried. I've tried, and it's great stuff. So when you're ready to do more and spread the word, we hope you'll come back and do it with us.
Will do. And thanks again for having me on, guys. It's good times. I think we're going to get a little bit of rain here shortly, so it's going to be a little entertaining, but that's okay. I'll be waddling around in mud and making some good time.
That's good. Will, take care. Best of luck out there and with everything you're doing. Hopefully we get the opportunity to catch up with you again soon. In between now and then, all the best to you and your family, my friend.
Thanks, Will.
Guys. You guys be safe and enjoy yourselves.
All right. Thank you, Will. That is former Rams and Titans linebacker Will Witherspoon. And again, Shiregate Farm. Check it out. We ordered from there about a year or so ago. Great stuff. And certainly they're doing some great things, not only with the farm, with farmers insurance. And Will's just such a great guy and so much fun to be around. So honored that he's back on the show tonight. But Bob, you want to talk about a guy who had a great career as a linebacker and then you know, had an opportunity to play in the Super Bowl. Will Witherspoon is certainly one of the best.
Yeah, a variety of cities excelled wherever he was, but making me hungry, Chris, with all the farm talk and everything. But he's a very enterprising man, very busy man, very focused, and you could see the emphasis that was put on him from a very young age, that it wasn't all about football, and it's paying off right now.
That's exactly right. Good point.
All right, we've got our next guest, EJ Jr., hanging on the line. Before we get to EJ, I want to give a shout-out to our good friend Renee Schull over at Career Engagement Institute. Folks, if you're upside down in your career, and what we mean by that is you're ready to move on, go to careerengagement.institute to see how Renee can help you. You heard Toy Cook not all that long ago singing Renee's praises right here on the show. And if you work with Renee for 2 minutes, you're going to understand exactly why Toy did that and why we brag on Renee every single week here on Thursday Night Tailgate. You know, we all want to work with somebody who has actually, you know, our best interests at heart and that we can trust. And you're not going to find, you guys know how rare it is to find someone who fits that description. Well, you're not going to find anyone who does it any better than Renee Schull. She is smart, creative, very talented, the kind of person you want to work with and have working for you. Renee has been doing some great things for some of our guests who have been in transition from being pro athletes that are now getting into the job market. Folks, I am telling you, Renee is just the very best. There isn't a better way to describe her than that. If you're an athlete or anyone in the job market, do yourself a favor and reach out to Renee. You're going to be so very glad that you did. Go to careerengagement.institute online and give her a follow on Twitter at Integrated Play. All right, now back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line is EJ Jr. Let me remind you about EJ's background. Played his college ball at the University of Alabama, where he was a first-team All-American and a member of their back-to-back national championship teams in 1978 and 79. He was a first-round draft pick, the fifth overall selection by the then St. Louis Cardinals in 1981. Played linebacker in the NFL from 81 to 93 for the Cardinals, Dolphins, Bucks, and Seahawks. He was selected to the Pro Bowl in back-to-back seasons in 1984 and 85. Over the course of his career, he had 36 and a half sacks, 12 interceptions, 7 fumble recoveries, and he scored 1 touchdown. He is currently a candidate for induction into the College Football Hall of Fame. And as a member of the 2017 class that we are looking forward to, you know, hearing the announcements for, and the announcements for when the guys will be inducted or who is going to get inducted is going to be coming up in January. So very early in 2017. And as those of you who follow me on Facebook know, I'm a voting member of the National Football Foundation. And EJ is one of the guys I voted for this year. So I'm very excited to share the anticipation, I'm sure, with EJ, looking forward to see how the vote turns out. But we are very excited he is back with us again tonight here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, EJ, Chris, and Bob, thanks for coming back on the show.
Welcome back.
Thank you, guys. How are you all doing?
Excellent. Fantastic. Thank you. So, EJ, we got a ways to go, right, until we find out who the 2017 College Football Hall of Fame class is going to be. Like I say, it's January 6th. Is the date that we'll all find out who gets inducted this year. But talk about what it would mean to you to have your college football career, you know, end up with here now in Atlanta at the College Football Hall of Fame.
I think that would be the epitome of this college achievement. I was blessed to be around a great group of guys who helped me look good and being part of two national championship teams and other members who have been a part of this team, be a part of the National Football Foundation College Hall of Fame. It would be something that I think Coach Brown would always be tickled about, and I think it would be the best of the best. Not too many guys get a chance to play college ball, and then those who get selected for this Hall of Fame would be just a cherishable moment in my life.
And EJ, the last time that we got to spend some time with you was when Alabama was getting ready to play Michigan State in the playoffs. So clearly things went very well through all of that. So, but curious to get you know, as you're watching that game when they're playing against Clemson in the national championship game, were you nervous at all? Were you going crazy watching that game?
Well, to me, I think you still have some Alabama ties on the other side of the ball, too, when you look at Dabo Sweeney. But, you know, every game has its own tale. It has its own twist. It has its own turns. And even like when we played against Penn State in the 1978 national championship game against Penn State, you know, it was, you know, there were times that it could have gone either way. Both teams played a great game. It was just fortunate that Alabama was able to pull it out and get their last national championship to make it number, I think it's 16 now.
And EJ, being a guy, from Pittsburgh, I grew up, a big Pitt fan. And one of my favorite college football players of all time was Hugh Greene. And you got to play alongside of Hugh for a couple of years when you were with the Dolphins. Talk about
what it was like when the two of you teamed up together?
Oh, it was a lot of fun. As a matter of fact, I talked to Hugh about 2 weeks ago because George Rogers Golf Tournament was this past weekend, and I didn't get a chance to get down that way because we had our freshman class coming in for second session of summer school. But Hugh has always been an interesting character. I call him Huge. He always calls me Esther. but we've always had that common friendship. We've grown through the years. We drafted together. He was the number 7 pick in the 1981 draft. I knew what kind of player he was and the things that he did on field. I was surprised that Pittsburgh team never won a national championship, putting out 11 first and second round draft choices in the 1981 draft. So Hugh and I go back a long ways and talking about farms. I was listening earlier to your show. Hugh has a 900-acre farm in Natchez, Mississippi that he's been having since he played in the league. And
wow.
I grew up on a farm with a little bit from my grandfather down in Waycross, Georgia. So I kind of have some flashbacks when you mention farms. But Hugh is a good guy, and you know, works hard, loves to have fun, taught me a lot of things when we were with the Dolphins. Matter of fact, we were known as a great beard if you had Barry Krause in there because we were all over 30 years old. And then the offer dog was a little bit banged up that year, so we had Mike Ruckenbach at the other inside linebacker. So you had me, Barry Krause, Hugh Green, and Mike Ruckenbach, all of us over 30 years old. They called us the great beard. So it was a lot of fun.
Hey, it's interesting you say, you know, did he play in the George Rogers Golf Tournament? I got to imagine as a guy who finished second in the Heisman Trophy, he wasn't like, you know, trying to drive the ball into George or, you know, accidentally hitting the ball where George was at, was he?
No, he was kind of like always a supervisor. He's going to be there, but he's not going to play. Because I think he decided to retire his golf game. Now, had LT been there, it might have been a different story. But, you know, George get out there and play on one hole, and basically who can outdrive him on a par 3 hole. And George is pretty good at being on his backyard in South Carolina.
Bob, questions for EJ?
EJ, it's great to speak with you. We talked earlier in the show as far as Chris and I alluded a little bit to the toughness of practices and the way practices are conducted now compared to when you were in college. And having played for Bear Bryant, I know there was contact drills, EJ. I know that for a fact. So, I mean, give us a little insight into how tough it was playing for him. And was he one of these guys that was a hands-on coach, or was he more of a delegator?
At the time that I came into Coach Bryant's presence, he was more of a delegator. He coached the coaches, and the coaches coached us. He knew what he wanted, how he wanted. Now, he would come out of that tower and work on certain things. If he wanted to show you how to block or a certain position, how to tackle, he would come out of that tower real quick. So you got a chance to see him firsthand, even at his age. I really believe that when I was playing, he was mellowing out because my senior year, it was the first time Alabama got a chance to wear white shoes. They got a Nike contract with Nike, and that was the first time we ever had white shoes and had Bama on the back. I'm like, the old man is mellowing because we have white shoes. And then playing in the Cotton Bowl that year against Baylor, it was the first time that the players had their jerseys on, their name on the back of the jersey. So I felt like he was mellowing out. But as far as the contact drill, it was always a physical. We worked physically, mentally, emotionally, day in and day out. You know, there were drills that we would go through, gut checks, scrimmages, things that we would do to prepare us. And the things that we learned on the field had a lot of carryover off the field. And there are times that you didn't feel like you wanted to go out there and practice or do some things. And Coach Bryant's philosophy was, well, one of these days you're going to have children, and you might be on a job that you don't like. What are you going to do? Quit. If you got a family, you got to feed. Bills you have to pay. And so sometimes when you went through a lot of those drills to push yourself to a point that you didn't think you could do it anymore, you would always find a little bit more to get you over that hump. And matter of fact, it carried over in the national championship game against Penn State when we had the famous goal line stand. Marty Lyons looked at Chuck Fusino on the play and says, I think you better pass, because we had gone through gut checks. Nobody was tired. Nobody was, you know, surprised that we were on the goal line. We looked at it as another opportunity to show what we were able to do, and we came out victorious. So one of the things that Coach Bryant instilled you might be, you never say die. You never quit. You just keep pushing and do the best you can and just fall as they may. And sometimes that physicality carried over, you know, into the things that you do in life. And now with all the rules and, you know, worrying about the concussions and the way that the game has changed a lot, you still try to instill a tough mentality. We just have to be a lot smarter about how we go about doing it.
And you being a first-round draft pick, EJ, we always know that there's pressure on first-rounders no matter where they fall in that first round. But I assume from what you just said that the background with Coach Bryant and just the way you were raised kept you kind of grounded and it never got to your head.
No, it wasn't going to get to your head. Matter of fact, I was talking to one of my young coaches earlier today, and I was talking about the time that I got a chance to be a starter with the Cardinals, learning from the old guys like Dan Didoff, Tim Carney, Roger Worley, Jim Hart, you know, Mel Gray. Those were seniors and upperclassmen, as I would say, once I got to the pros. And they brought me in there to be a starter. And I came into camp 2 weeks late, and going into the first game of the season, Coach Jim Hanifin was going to name me the starter. And I said, well, did I beat out Tim Carney? He says, well, no, not really. I said, then you're going to start Tim Carney. And they all looked at me like you're crazy. He says, Rook, you're turning down a chance to start. I says, when I beat you, you'll know. But I haven't done anything to earn the job yet. And he says, well, you know they're training you to take my job. I says, well, when that time comes, I'll be prepared. Not to know that Tim Carney was going to get hurt in week two versus the Dallas Cowboys, and I was going to be starting the rest of the year. But
right. That
was just mutual respect, teaching the young pup how leadership comes. And I've always been humble. Anytime I've gone to a Hall of Fame, I don't take personal credit. I give it all to the guys that I played with, be it the Tennessee Hall of Fame or the Alabama Sports Hall of Fame. Those guys made me look good. And it would be the same thing in the college football Hall of Fame. I didn't do it by myself. There were 22 guys who we practiced, fought, played together to help me be the person that I am. And I give the credit to those guys because we won the championships. It wasn't me. You know, we had great coaches, and Coach Donahue, Sylvester Croom, who's with the Tennessee Titans, Coach Donahue, God rest his soul, Bill Oliver, you know, Mal Moore, God rest his soul. You know, they've done a lot to help me become the young man on and off the field. Even in spite of my shortcomings, I was blessed by God to have a great group of coaches and mentors. And then playing for Coach Bryant and then going on to the pros and playing for Jim Hanifin and Gene Stallings and Don Shula and Tom Flores, you know, those values carried over. So when you look at team, there's no I in it. You work as a group. We work as a unit. We work as a machine. And that machine is like a 12-cylinder Jag. And if one of those parts don't function properly, that car doesn't run well. So I was just part of a big machine to do what I do, and I'm just blessed to have that opportunity.
EJ, you were when you were with the Cardinals, you know, you were there at the time when they made the move away from St. Louis and to go out to Phoenix. You know, how hard was that for you guys, leaving the fans of St. Louis behind? And does the Rams move now out to L.A. make you feel badly again for the fans of St. Louis? They're kind of going through it all over again?
I do. I really sympathize for the people in St. Louis because when we were there, you know, the football team was always considered the second, the stepchild of the baseball team. The baseball team has always been the main team because it was a baseball city. But the war between Mayor Shamel and Bill Bidwell just went back and forth, and, you know, all of it was over getting a new stadium. It was ironic once we left to go to Phoenix. How much of a void that it left, and you know, the people of St. Louis did a lot to endear us with them. You know, being in the community, going to the school, putting on football camps, golf tournaments, you know, playing softball during the summers, you know, the off-season jobs, because we didn't make the millions of dollars that these guys make now. We have off-season jobs. The commitment to family, churches, and friends, it was a hard pill to swallow. to start all over, pick up your bags and move, and then start all over again. And to see the Rams go back to California, I'm sure it's very disheartening. But, you know, the city of Los Angeles lost the Rams to St. Louis. They just got a chance to get them back. Unfortunately, I don't think the Cardinals are going to come back to St. Louis. And I pray one day that there will be another team to play in St. Louis. I just don't think it will ever be the same.
And, EJ, you're now at Delaware State. You talk about the kids coming back and the things you're doing. Talk about, you know, coaching at Delaware State, coaching their defensive line, and your experience so far being a coach there with the Hornets.
Well, I'm enjoying it. I was the head coach at Central State for several years. I got a chance to move up to the FCS level and get a chance to work with a great group of coaches. I think we have way too much fun sometimes. We got three former head coaches, two that I know. John Allen was a coach that I knew over in NFL Europe, who was a head coach at a Division II college. I knew him. And Vince White, who played with John Elway in Stanford, is our running back coach. He's been a head coach before. And out of all the players, all the coaches on our staff, only two have not been coordinators or head coaches. So we have a great group of coaches who are young and have some maturity. It's going to be a fun season. We had our bumps and bruises last year, but we got a chance to recruit two classes. I think we'll do some great things this year. We'll make an impact in the MEAC. And our goal is to be in Atlanta for the Celebration Bowl and against the FLAC. And the team that won it last year, which was North Carolina A&T, we weren't that far from beating them in their own backyard. So we have a lot of young people. We have an upswing that we're looking for, and we'll let the chips fall where they may at the end of the season. And hopefully we'll be in Atlanta when it's all said and done.
There you go. Bob, yeah. One more for EJ before we let him go.
And EJ, when you left the game, the NFL in 93, is coaching something that was immediately on your mind, or did you test the waters of other things before you decided, this might be for me?
Well, I had been a drug and alcohol therapist and counselor several years before I retired, and I was really looking into getting into NFL administration, looking to become a director of player development, which I did do that for a couple of years with the Miami Dolphins. But it just so happened as I tore up my knee and ended my career in 1994, Rusty Pillman and Coach Flores asked me if I ever thought about coaching. And I was brought there in Seattle at the end of my career to help a young group of linebackers be better. And I actually was kind of like a coach on the field and in the meetings and things. And they looked at me well enough to say, well, we brought him here as a coach on the field. We might as well give him a chance to be a coach off the field. And I got my first taste of coaching and got away from it a little bit. But, you know, always had that itch to be in it. And been doing it for a while now, so I'm enjoying it, and maybe I'll get another shot to be a head coach. I'm not trying to jump in that chair anytime soon, but I'm loving doing what I'm doing because this is a lot of fun. I get a chance to teach what was taught to me, and hopefully we'll do some great things and have some success, and we'll see how it all ends.
EJ, remind our listeners how they can follow you online and over social media.
Well, a lot of times I'm on Facebook, of course, and I cannot even remember my Twitter page. We do so much recruiting on it, but I think it's EJunior _1 on Twitter. I have to go back and look at it because I'm always tweeting and retweeting. But I'm going to always be available. I can be reached on email at ejunior@desu.edu. Because I'm also the director of player development for the program, and wishing you all guys the best. It's an honor to always come on your show, and we'll see how this
all
thing
right.
ends up in December, where I am with the Hall of Fame.
Yeah, absolutely. You know we're rooting hard for you. So hopefully between now and then, you know, you know Delaware State takes a big step forward. Their defense looks really strong, and we get a positive outcome on this College Football Hall of Fame. We'd love nothing more, EJ, than to be able to celebrate with you here on the air and talk about your induction into the College Football Hall of Fame, richly deserved.
Thank you, Chris, and thank you, Bob.
Anytime.
EJ, take care. All the best to you and your family, my friend.
All right, many blessings to you guys.
Good night.
Thanks, EJ.
Good night. Bye-bye.
That is Alabama legend and former Cardinals and Dolphins linebacker EJ Jr. And, Bob, you want to talk about a guy, you know, I mean, and we've talked with EJ about his trials and tribulations in the past, and he's, you know, rose up from them and made his way back. There's certainly no one better. And we've talked about, you know, EJ in conjunction with Tony Collins and Tim Worley, who are all, you know, wonderful friends of ours now and that we think so highly of, and the teachings that they have now for young men. There's no one better than EJ Jr. To get in front of, you know, young kids, whether it's at Delaware State or wherever it might be, to talk about, you know, how to get through those sorts of things, how to deal with them, how to, you know, rise above them, and then the great things that he's doing now. It's absolutely, you know, heartwarming. And I can't say enough how much I am rooting for him to get into the College Football Hall of Fame.
Oh, same here, Chris. There is no, you know, I'm dating myself, but I mean, this guy I watched play at Bama while I was in high school. One of the best linebackers I've ever seen at the college level, and then that is it's attested by the fact that he was a first-round draft pick. Amazing. A guy, of course, when you cut your teeth under Coach Bryant, it makes you a different person, and he made that very clear. But he's exactly where he needs to be right now, Chris, sharing all this experience. And you could see why they won championships back then, because they were so team-oriented. And that's what he's passing on to young people right now.
Yeah, and it's sort of been the theme of the show tonight, right? Team-oriented. So many of the guys tonight talking about that, and it's exactly right on, right? And like EJ talked about, you never get anywhere in any sport on your own. You never get anywhere in life all on your own, right? It's all about, you know, the people that you surround yourself with, whether it's a team you're on or a team you form, whether that's your friends or the people that, you know, you hang out with or the organizations you associate yourself with. But it's all about team, and it's collectively that you win championships. No one wins championship on their own.
Yeah, can you picture any player at Alabama back in those days, Chris, pumping their chest, saying, so-and-so. No. So that was, I think he got a lot of his team background from a coach named Bear.
Bob and I come back. We'll be turning on the Thursday Night Tailgate Spotlight. Positive, hear which players are doing great things in their communities. And then we'll wrap up the show, and we'll do all that on the other side of these words from our friends over at Coastal Orthopedics, Kyven Foods, and the French Lick Resort.
Are you suffering from chronic pain in your shoulders, hips, knees, or wrists? Tired of living life with an old injury that just won't go away? If you answered yes to either of these questions, we can help. At Coastal Orthopedics and Sports Medicine, Dr. Candelora and his fine staff of medical professionals will get you back on the road to recovery. Their state-of-the-art facility and attention to detail will ensure you will be enjoying life again and feeling invincible in no time. Since 1991, Dr. Candelora and Coastal Orthopedics have been specializing in joint replacement, arthritis, and osteoporosis care, as well as pediatric and adult general orthopedics. Visit us on the web, www.bone-dr.com, or call our Newport Richey office just north of Tampa at 727-848-1417. Proud sponsors of Mike Ditka's The Gridiron Greats Assistance Fund.
This is Reggie Kelly, former Cincinnati Bengals and Atlanta Falcon tight end, and I'm the owner of Kyven Foods. And if you enjoy delicious food, you're going to love my Kyven products, which consist of our honey apple salsa, sweet barbecue sauce, and an array of seasonings. For store locations, online orders, and recipes, check out our website at www.kyven82.com. That's KYVAN82.com. One taste, and you'll appreciate the goodness.
Now's the time to plan that golf getaway you've been dreaming about at French Lick Resort. We have new Golf Academy packages for 2016, guaranteed to take your game to the next level. Try our one-day Quick Fix Academy for golf emergencies. For more in-depth learning, try the Game Changer, designed to make you a better player. Our staff professionals are ready to work with you at French Lick Resort. Did you know there's only one place in the country that you can play courses designed by two members of the World Golf Hall of Fame on the same property? The Pete Dye and Donald Ross courses at French Lick Resort make us an ultimate golf destination for 2016. Check out the Ultimate Golf Package, the Hall of Fame Package, and other great offerings at FrenchLick.com. Let 2016 be that year you finally take your dream golf getaway at French Lick Resort. Play the courses champions play.
Hey, hey, welcome back. This is Todd Washington, two-time Super Bowl champ, offensive line coach for the Baltimore Ravens, and you are listening to Thursday Night Tailgate with my boys Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari on the Armed Forces Radio Network. Go get them, guys.
And we're back here on Thursday Night Tailgate, and we're turning on our spotlight on the positive. Bob, who do you got for us this week?
Chris, I got to give a shout-out to one of your Steelers, Cameron Hayward. Yeah, I was reading about some of the things he was doing in the community, and, of course, dating myself again, we all remember his father, Craig Ironhead Hayward, who sadly we lost him to cancer in 2006, but it seems like he's doing things in honor of his father. First of all, what impressed me was when I read about his birthday last year. Instead of throwing his own party, Chris, no, he goes out and throws a party for kids that were in the child welfare system in Pennsylvania. And he's done other things. He's very, very involved in the United Way. One of the things that really got to me was he is very involved in this Project Bundle Up, where a lot of your Steelers there in Pittsburgh, Chris, they actually go shopping with some underprivileged kids, and they buy them winter outerwear, which, you know how it gets in Pittsburgh in the winter. But that's the kind of guy this, he's been doing. He's been seen a lot at the children's hospitals in Pittsburgh, and just a lot of things like that. And, of course, again, in honor of his father, very involved in various cancer causes. So props to Cameron Hayward of the Pittsburgh Steelers tonight.
Thank you very much for that, Bob. Yeah, Cam is fantastic. And, Bob, I want to put the spotlight on Seattle Seahawks fullback Derek Coleman Jr. Derek became deaf at the age of 3 and is the first legally deaf player in NFL history. He has been an inspiration to many, and through his No Excuse Foundation, he encourages those with similar challenges to pursue their dreams despite any obstacles that that arise to them. Derek plays by using a combination of hearing aids, lip reading, and hand signals. He was an undrafted free agent, despite rushing for over 1,100 yards and 11 touchdowns in his final 2 years at UCLA. And, oh, by the way, running a 4.4 40 at the NFL Combine for a guy who's 6 foot, 230 pounds. So being very impressive, still went undrafted. He's now the starting fullback for the Seattle Seahawks, beating out Pro Bowler Michael Robinson. He was featured in a Duracell ad, for hearing aids, and because he uses the Duracell, right, in the hearing aids that he wears. And he inspired two twin sisters who also wear hearing aids, and the sisters wrote him a letter of support that was so moving that both Derek and Duracell invited the sisters to watch Super Bowl 48 in person. Remember the Seahawks winning Super Bowl 48. So kudos to Derek Coleman for not listening, if you will, to all those who told him that he couldn't overcome being deaf and he couldn't, overcome being not drafted, and not letting anyone stand in his way to realize his NFL dreams, and turning others, that are dealing with, hearing issues, and helping them, pursue the dreams, that that they have through his foundation. That's what his foundation does. They try to sponsor, kids, to try to fulfill their dreams, whether it's in sports or academics or whatever it's about. They try to help those kids, reach their potentials by giving them opportunities that they may not have been able to get. So kudos to Derek Coleman Jr. for what he's doing to help other people that are dealing with the sort of issues that he has dealt with his whole life, overcome those and realize their dreams, Bob.
And as we said, Chris, we wouldn't have been able to just talk about those two guys without doing some research into it. And there's a kind of a problem there because it's never publicized enough. We have to go find it. And, of course, the bad stuff, easy to come across. So that's the best part of, I think, what we do and the most fun part is looking up what these guys do. And we're just fascinated that they're not just involved in one thing. They kind of spread their their beauty and wealth throughout the giving part of what they do, and it's tremendous stuff. And the problem I have with it is we have to go dig it up because it's not in people's faces, and it's our job to get it out there.
Yeah, you know, Bob, and you make a really great point there. And, you know, we talk about it, you know, during this segment every single week, right? You know, that, you know, to your point, you know, the bad stuff, you know, the Johnny Manziel stories, you know, are on the front page, easy to find. You know, you Google Johnny Manziel, there's a million stories that come up. It's so, you know, it's everywhere. But when you're trying to say, you know, hey, there are a lot more guys doing a lot of great stuff and it's out there, but you're right. You got to really dig around, search for it and try, you know, different ways to find it. Because putting in, you know, a simple Google search about, you know, NFL players, you know, doing good or NFL players impacting their community or any of that sort of stuff, not a lot comes up. You really got to dig around to find it, which is, you know, what we say, right? That's a sad statement, you know, for us in our society that, you know, these types of stories, if they're publicized at all, it's on page 12 or it's, you know, 12 pages into your Google results that come back. Meanwhile, when you want to find out, you know, who got arrested for drugs or this or that or the other thing in the NFL, boy, those stories, boom, right up there when you do your Google search.
So true, and we'll keep digging, Chris. I don't mind digging. That's stuff
right.
That needs to be out there, right?
Right, yeah, and this is the stuff, right? This is the stuff that, you know, we're trying to get out there every single week, right? That's why we do the Thursday Night Tailgate Spotlight on the Positive, because we want you to know who are doing the good things. You can find who are doing the bad things. They're in your face all day long, whether it's on CNN Headline News or ESPN News. You're hammered with it, you know, all day long on the radio or whatever it is you're watching or looking at. Boy, those are easy to find, right? We got to make sure that the guys that are doing great stuff, and again, 99% of the guys in the league are doing great things, right? They've got foundations. They're involved in their communities. They're doing things, you know, for people that are, you know, underprivileged or less fortunate than themselves. They're doing things with food banks, you know, around the holidays and Christmas presents for kids that don't, you know, get to enjoy Christmas the way, you know, a lot of kids do. So they're out there doing those things. But, boy, you know, you're not going to find that on ESPN or you're not going to see that on CNN Headline News, but you're going to find out about Johnny Manziel every single day. So that's why you tune in here. The Thursday Night Tailgate Spotlight on the Positive. We're going to bring you those guys and the differences that they're making in their respective communities.
Right.
All right, Bob, it is time for us to put a bow on this episode of Thursday Night Tailgate. We want to thank again Mike Bass, Tony Collins, Dr. Stephen Novicky, Will Witherspoon, and EJ Jr. for joining us tonight. Bob, like I always say, my friend, the best part of Thursday nights is getting to spend a couple hours with you.
Oh, same here, Chris. You know, what's better than doing an inspirational show with a very good friend? And I thank you for your efforts.
I appreciate that. Next week, friends, well, I'm going to be on vacation. I'm going to be down on Tybee Island enjoying the beach. So we will take a 1 week hiatus here on Thursday Night Tailgate. And, you know, Bob, you know, being down there I love, you know, walking on the beach. I love looking at the ocean, you know, when you're, you know, on a balcony overlooking, you know, seeing the ocean coming in and hearing the waves and all that sort of stuff, you know, and I enjoy eating the things that come out of the ocean. I'm, you know, but I tell you what, Bob, I'm not going in the ocean, right? I never go in the ocean. You know, it's sort of, you know, the minute you step in the ocean, folks, you become part of the food chain. So, you know, I'm not going to give, you know, the fish that I enjoy eating and the things that I enjoy eating, that, you know, seafood, an opportunity sort of to turn the tables on me. I don't know about you, Bob. No swimming in the ocean for me.
Nah, Chris, and we don't move as quick as we once did. So, yeah, stay near the shore and take in some of the other better scenery that's known to be down on the beaches in the south. I'm sure you'll do fine with that.
Right. So, you know, we're taking next week off, folks. But speaking of the ocean, when we're back with you again on Thursday, July 14th, we'll be joined by a trio of Dolphins that night. So we're looking forward to having former Dolphins fullback Don Nottingham back with us, former Dolphins linebacker Dwight Hollier also making a return visit, and our good friend and TNT Hall of Famer, former Dolphins and Jets offensive lineman John Bach, going to be back with us. So a trio of Dolphins that night. We'll also be joined by former Falcons wide receiver Brian Finneran as well. And then, of course, you know, Tony Collins, you know, former Patriots Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins with us every single week here on Thursday Night Tailgate. So we look forward to all of those guys when we're back here again Thursday, July the 14th. Want to remind everyone, how can you on social media? Well, we got a Thursday Night Tailgate Facebook page. We hope you'll check out
page there and give us a like. That's very important to us as well. On Twitter, you can find me. I'm at chris-mascaro. Bob is at bob_lazzari. The show is at TNT Podcast. We both have pages on Facebook as well. You can find me, Chris Mascaro, Bob Lazzari. We both have our own Facebook pages. You can interact with us there as well. Plus, you can stay up to date with who some of our future guests are going to be, and you can stream or download any of our archive episodes by going to our website, ThursdayNightTailgate.com. Bob, take us home, my friend.
Okay, Chris, you enjoy the beach, and again, leave the flippers at home, okay?
Indeed, no worries, my friend. I'm not getting anywhere near
you. All right,
you.
And again, thanks go out to our announcer, Joe LaGenusa, for the great job he always does with our weekly intro and ads. And to James Brocato and all the guys from Painted Faces for our upcoming outro music. On behalf of myself and Chris, we thank everyone tonight for listening. We appreciate all of you very, very much. Until next week, good night, Kevin. We miss you.